Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Classmate by Will McIntosh, narrated by Erik Bloomquist. Chapter 1. I'd never been on a quieter school bus. Kids were whispering to each other in tight, breathless tones as the bus clipped stray branches from the endless forest pressing in on either side of us. "This isn't even a two-way road," I murmured to Lorena, the girl sitting beside me. When we'd loaded onto the bus in Annapolis, she dropped down beside me and just started talking. Normally, I wasn't comfortable talking to people I didn't know, especially attractive girls my age, but Lorena had made it easy, keeping the conversation going for 4 hours, effortlessly filling in the awkward pauses I created. But even she had grown quieter when the bus had turned down this road. Lorena peered out the window. "Where is this school? My folks told me this would be the greatest thing ever for my college application, but I don't know about this. This is freaky." My mom had said the same thing. She'd said it was an educational program for the country's best and brightest. If it was successful, the government might expand it nationwide. She seemed to think the purpose of my entire childhood was to prepare me to get into a good college. I got as much say in this boarding school decision as I'd gotten when it came to competing on the neighborhood swim team or attending math camp all last summer when all I'd wanted to do was decompress and play video games. Which was to say, I got no say. Nothing I had said could change her mind. Dad, meanwhile, had been too busy bending over backward in his efforts to be liked by his new wife and stepchildren to even express an opinion about where I went to school. The road was a jet-black ribbon of blacktop that looked like it had been poured yesterday. The bus we were riding in, on the other hand, was old. My seat had a hole in the vinyl with foam bulging out of it. I plucked at the foam nervously.
"What do your parents do?"
Lorena asked. "Dad works for the power company. My mom's in the CIA. Lorena looked impressed, so I added, "Don't picture someone in cool sunglasses traveling the world with a bunch of different aliases. She's a dork. She does data analysis." And what an argument I'd had with my dork mother over the phone. I still couldn't wrap my mind around that. Out of nowhere, she had convinced Dad to agree to pull me out of school and send me to a boarding school. Mom had said we couldn't refuse, given the stakes. I was in middle school. My college application 6 years from now? Is that what she considered high stakes? Probably.
"You said you don't see your mom much, right?"
Lorena asked. "Vacations, mostly. How about you? What do your parents do?" The bus broke out of the trees so suddenly it startled me. The question forgotten, we peered out the window. A high, black, steel fence ran along the roadside like something out of a maximum security prison. Up ahead, massive security gates swung open as we approached. I watched them shut behind us, fighting a rising claustrophobic panic. Lorena pressed in beside me to get a better look. "What is this? Is this a school or a prison?" The narrow strip of blacktop took us into a wide, flat field, but I could see the fence curving around us in the distance. Why would there be a huge security fence around a boarding school? New places made me nervous enough when they didn't have giant fences around them.
"Look at that!"
a tall, skinny kid in the back of the bus called, pointing to my right. We were passing beautifully landscaped brick walkways and gorgeous park areas with fountains and benches. I reached for my phone to snap a few photos, then remembered we hadn't been allowed to bring our phones, because they interfered with your concentration. They distracted you from your academic pursuits. These were the same reasons I'd been given for why the school was in the middle of nowhere. All part of the plan to turbocharge our young minds, if we didn't lose them first. The wide brick walkway was lined with shops, including an ice cream parlor and an arcade. That I had not expected. At least there'd be something to do besides school. Still, this place was beyond weird. We pulled onto a loop road that ringed a big oval lawn. On the other side of the lawn sat a one-story brown brick deal with evenly spaced windows along the front that screamed middle school. As we got back to our seats, I wiped my clammy palms on my pants. Until now, I had held it together pretty well, but the sight of the school had my heart thrumming. I'd never been away from home, except for the occasional sleepover. And even those made me nervous. The truth was, everything made me nervous.
Wait, is that what it looks like?
An auburn-haired girl in a private school jacket was pointing over the rooftop of the three-story building to our left, where a cherry-red track snaked high into the air. There was no mistaking it. It was the top of a roller coaster. Not a big job like you'd find at Busch Gardens, but more like something at a traveling carnival. Still, it was a roller coaster. The bus squealed to a stop in front of a big building that looks like a town hall, with white pillars and wide concrete steps. The driver, a guy in his 40s with a perfect haircut who looked nothing like a school bus driver, pointed, "Straighten those blue doors. Don't worry about your luggage. It'll be delivered to your dorm rooms." My legs were shaking as I climbed down the steps of the bus behind Lorena. I half expected that now that we were off the bus, Lorena would wander off to find cooler kids to hang out with. But as we stepped off, she glanced back to make sure I was still there. "I am freaking out right now," she said. "This place has bad vibes." She held her hands up, palms out, like she could feel them. A woman with short silver hair wearing a gray suit stood waiting just inside the doors of the building, which was a wide-open atrium. She led us into a room filled with rows of seats, like in a movie theater. There was a packet on each seat. I wiped my sweaty palms and picked mine up. An exhausted-looking woman, giving us a big, enthusiastic smile, stood at a podium up front. Her black hair was tied back so tightly it tugged the skin on her cheeks and the corners of her eyes. "Welcome to Sagan Middle School. My name is Ms. Spain." She took a sip from a bottle of water. "You've been selected from thousands of students to take part in this unique program. What you learn here will change your lives and the lives of countless others." I exchanged a look with Lorena. Countless others? Yes, I was sure we were going to change countless lives with our tireless pursuit of pre-algebra here at Sagan Middle School.
"Why don't we start with some of the basic rules?" Ms. Spain said. "Some of the rules will seem strange, but you must follow them if you want to complete the program successfully. Now, open the envelope that was on your seat."
Ms. Spain told us to take out our earpieces, and she held up one so we could find ours in the envelopes. I located mine rolling around at the bottom. It was pea-sized and clear.
"Insert the earpiece into your left ear,"
she demonstrated with the one she was holding. I had no idea what this was about, but I did as I was told. The earpiece was small enough that it stuck down low.
"From this moment on, you are to keep the earpiece in your left ear at all times, even when you're sleeping," Miss Spain said.
I looked over at Lorena, who gave me a look like, "Can you believe this?"
"Whenever a prompter says something to you through your earpiece, you are to immediately repeat it aloud."
Miss Spain held up a finger.
"Unless the first word is direction or do not repeat. A direction is something you are to do, not say. If your prompter begins with do not repeat, he or she has something to say to you. If it's a question, answer out loud. Does everyone understand?"
Everyone nodded. No one was sticking the earpiece in their nose or talking or fidgeting in their seats. This was nothing like my school at home, which I already missed, even though I had not been particularly popular there. I reached for my phone, wanting to get a picture of this orientation to show to people when I got home. Then I remembered I didn't have it anymore.
"What the heck is going on?"
Lorena was staring at her earbud, pinched between her thumb and finger. The auburn-haired girl in the private school jacket shushed Lorena. Lorena glared over her shoulder at the girl. The look was clearly a warning not to shush her ever again. I missed my phone. I wasn't sure I could go 4 phoneless months without having a complete mental breakdown.
"You've been chosen not just because you're intelligent, but also because of your maturity," Miss Spain went on. "We are counting on that maturity."
She paused and looked up and down the rows, making eye contact with each of us.
"Tomorrow you'll meet a very special classmate. She looks different than you or anyone you've ever met. She..."
Miss Spain trailed off.
trying to find the right words. I'll be honest, you might find her frightening to look at, but it's important you don't stare. Treat her like any other student. Your prompters will guide you through the earbuds.
There was more about schedules and mealtimes, when we'd get to call home, and all of the fun we were going to have at the movie theater, the ice cream shop, and the carnival. But it was hard to concentrate, because the same words kept echoing in my head.
You might find her frightening to look at.
What did that mean? Was she a burn victim? Did she have that elephant man disease where parts of her were horribly swollen? I didn't like this. From the looks on their faces, my new classmates didn't either. I stopped in the doorway of my room, horrified. The room was lined with low, cot-like beds. 8 of them. No one had said anything about roommates, let alone 8 of them. I'd been looking forward to having some alone time. At home, my bedroom was my refuge from my 3 step-siblings, the place where I could relax and think my private thoughts in peace. Lorena squeezed past me. Ooh, dibs on the window! She ran toward the bed closest to the window and leaped onto it, bouncing. She stretched out, cradled her head in her palms, and let out a satisfied sigh. Co-ed? The dorms were co-ed? I wasn't going to survive this place. As a few other kids passed me, I raced to claim the bed closest to Lorena. If I was going to share a room with 7 other people, I was at least going to sleep near the one person I knew. I took a seat on the bed to claim it and looked around what would be my bedroom for the next 4 months. There were paintings on the wall that you might see in a hotel room. A beach scene, a farmhouse seen through a picket fence, an abstract with a lot of purple. As I sat there, it occurred to me that I was probably sharing a bathroom with a bunch of people as well. This was a nightmare.
This is pretty sweet,
a stocky baby-faced guy, 2 beds down and across from me said, staring at the ceiling from his bed. He sat up.
Hey, we should organize a touch football game on that field in front of the school.
A couple of the other people in the room seemed interested. I acted like I hadn't heard him. Lorena sprang up. We should take turns telling creepy stories after lights out.
No, a thin girl whose bed was close to the door said. I don't want to be up all night.
I was pretty sure I was going to be up all night either way. Chapter 2. I headed into the cafeteria, my hair still wet from showering, and looked around for a place to sit. The prospect of plunking down among a group of kids I didn't know made me wildly uncomfortable. A waving hand caught my attention. It was Lorena, sitting at an otherwise empty table in the corner by the window. Relieved, I hurried over. Lorena gave me a big smile.
How's it going?
She was clearly a morning person, no sign of sleepiness in her brown eyes. Okay, I guess. That was all the enthusiasm I could muster at 8 a.m. The cafeteria was like a restaurant. There were waiters to take your order, and they had everything. Pancakes, eggs cooked to order, French toast, Cocoa Puffs, frozen yogurt, anything you could think of. It was cool, but I also found it a little creepy. What sort of school has waiters? Lorena had ordered everything, or just about. She had 3 plates in front of her. She caught me gawking at her breakfast and stopped mid-chew.
What?
Nothing, it's just... You've got an amazing appetite. She forked another hunk of blueberry pancakes into her mouth.
I know. I always eat like this. I must have an incredible metabolism.
I, on the other hand, didn't have much appetite when I was in strange new places. I picked up my chocolate chip pancakes, each bit feeling like it was clinging to the sides of my throat on the way down. Lorena was studying me.
You okay?
Don't take this the wrong way, but you seem, like, way tense. I laughed. I had a nervous laugh that came braying out sometimes when nothing was funny. I'm always way tense. I have an anxiety disorder. Being sent to a strange boarding school on 2 days' notice definitely doesn't help it.
What is an anxiety disorder exactly? I mean, I've heard of it, obviously, but I don't totally get it.
It's just, you feel anxious a lot of the time. I felt uncomfortable saying too much about it. I wanted Lorena to understand why I seemed way tense, but I didn't really want to dwell on it. Lorena leaned in closer.
But why? What causes it?
The way my psychologist explained it, my anxiety volume button is broken, basically. We all have a baseline level of anxiety. If you have low baseline anxiety, you mostly get anxious if there's a good reason, like you have to give a speech in front of a bunch of people or you're going to have surgery. Then there are people like me. Most mornings, I wake up feeling like I'm going to have to give a speech and then have surgery. Most kids I told looked embarrassed for me or uncomfortable. Lorena looked genuinely concerned, which was a nice change. I felt so lucky we'd ended up sitting together on the bus ride in. Lorena was so easy to talk to. She was good at filling awkward silences, which were my specialty.
Is there anything that can fix it?
She asked. I shrugged. My psychologist helps a little. Medication helps, but I still spend most of my time feeling anxious.
That sucks.
Another student stopped at our table. She was African American, her head nearly shaved, freckles running across the bridge of her nose. She was small, but everyone was supposed to be in seventh grade, so she must have just been small for her age. She had an intense expression. Not angry, but no smile in sight.
Have a seat,
Lorena said, gesturing. We've got tons of room. Which is what you're supposed to say to make someone feel welcome. Me? I just sat there saying nothing, feeling awkward in the presence of a new face. I was disappointed someone had broken up our table for two. I felt more comfortable talking to one person at a time, where I knew when it was my turn to speak and didn't have to try to jump in when there was a pause. Plus, Lorena was the only person I sort of knew here. I didn't want to lose the one friend I had or end up as the tag-along like I usually did. A waiter came over to take the new girl's order. The girl ordered all healthy stuff. Fruit, yogurt, whole grain waffle.
Have either of you heard anything from your earbud yet?
She asked as the waiter walked off.
I haven't heard squat from mine.
Me neither, Lorena said. I just shook my head. The earbud was uncomfortable. It partially blocked my ear canal, making sounds louder in one ear than the other. It also made me feel strangely off balance. Lorena stuck out her hand.
I'm Lorena, by the way. Persephone.
Benjamin, I mumbled. Persephone stuck out her hand, and we shook as well.
I don't understand what they're going to use them for, Persephone said. We're in school, but some stranger is going to tell us what to say?
Maybe they can feed us answers on our tests, I ventured as I poured more syrup on my chocolate chip pancakes so they'd go down more easily. Lorena chuckled at my joke and went back to fueling up.
So where are you from?
She asked Persephone.
Baltimore.
A city girl. And it goes without saying that you're exceptionally mature or you wouldn't be here. Lorena joked. Persephone gave a sharp, harsh laugh.
I'm exceptionally something.
The bell rang. Everyone started filing out of the cafeteria.
Well, here we go.
Lorena took a deep breath. Persephone fell into step beside us as we filed out. She was wearing all black. T-shirt, loose pants, tennis shoes. We cut through a gate and headed across the center courtyard, toward the school. Persephone pointed as we walked.
You can see more of those carnival rides from here.
The roller coaster had a big sign on it with Cyclone in yellow lettering. There was a high corkscrew drop at the end. Beside the Cyclone was a Ferris wheel, then one of those ships that swung back and forth, an alpine sled ride, and then a row of game booths.
I wonder if we'll get to ride them,
Lorena said. I've never been on a roller coaster. You've never been to Great Escape or Busch Gardens? I asked. Lorena threw her hands in the air. I've never been anywhere.
They said we wouldn't need money while we're here, Persephone said. Either that means the rides are free or we aren't going to get to ride them.
That would stink to have carnival rides sitting right there and not get to ride them, Lorena said as we reached our new school. The doors to Sagan Middle School were propped wide open. Despite the school-like appearance of the outside, the inside was weird. It had no metal detectors, no security guard. There were no lockers in the hallway, just freshly painted white walls. The strange, empty building gave me a crawling sensation, but I got that feeling in all strange new places, and sometimes in familiar old places as well.
What do you think the deal is with this special student? Persephone asked. Her appearance might scare us? What does that even mean?
Direction, a man's voice said through my earpiece, startling me. Change the topic. Talk about something pleasant. How good breakfast was, or a recent movie you saw.
I could tell from Lorena's and Persephone's expressions that they'd just gotten their first earbud direction as well, and they were also disturbed to realize people were listening in on our conversation.
Okay, then. Lorena cleared her throat. This place is going to be fun. How about those Packers? Read any good books lately?
Persephone said, grinning as we headed into the classroom. I slowed as I stepped through the doorway. It was taking up two seats pushed together. It was bluish and lumpy with all of these folds, and oh man, were those her eyes or her ears? She was wearing a purple dress and weird round patent leather shoes, and a bow was in her hair, only it wasn't hair, it was more like black spaghetti, and I couldn't breathe. The thing in the seats flexed, and suddenly it wasn't lumpy anymore. It was hard and sharp with pointy barbs sticking out of it. It hissed like a giant punctured tire.
Direction, the man's voice said through my earpiece. Do not stare. Put a smile on your face. Find your seat and face the board.
Panting, shaking, I looked at the name cards tented on the desks, searching for my name. When I finally spotted it, my insides felt like they were turning to water. My seat was right next to the thing.
Direction. Take a deep breath and sit down, the earpiece voice said. Do not repeat. She won't hurt you.
Pressing my hands on desktops to stay upright as I passed, I slid into my seat and leaned as far away from the thing as I could. The muscles in my neck so tight I heard a creak when I turned to look at the board. I could hear it breathing beside me. A hiss like a bicycle tire inflating and deflating. I couldn't get those ear eyes out of my mind. The jet black dots darting around in the centers must have been its eyes, but they were surrounded by thick, dark purple folds and ridges that resembled the outsides of ears. It had no neck, just a wide purple head attached right to its massive torso. A few kids gasped as they filed into the room, but I didn't look. I kept my eyes on the board as I'd been instructed. The voice knew what was going on, and I didn't, so I was going to do exactly what it said. The teacher, a middle-aged woman with dark, curly hair, breezed into the room with a bright smile on her face. She acted like there was nothing strange going on, welcomed us to the school, introduced herself as Ms. Bazzini, and started taking attendance. When she called my name, I said, "Here," in a tight squeak that barely made it out of my throat. Then she called Eve and looked to my right at the beast. Ms. Bazzini raised her eyebrows, encouraging Eve. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw the thing tentatively raise a fingerless hand. Ms. Bazzini beamed and nodded. She called the next name. What was this thing? I wanted so badly to bolt from my seat and climb over that fence and keep running until I was safe in my room under my blanket. I made eye contact with Lorena, who was leaning off the edge of her seat to be as far away from it as she could, even though she was on the other side of the room.
Wow, she mouthed silently.
Direction, eyes front, earbud guy said.
I turned to face front and looked around for the camera this guy was using to see my every move. I couldn't find it. Someone near the back of the room was crying quietly. I glanced back. It was a kid with bushy brown hair named Drew who slept in my dorm room. There was no math, no science,
A ton of recent history, a little English, and then... etiquette.
Etiquette?
There was no such class in school as etiquette. We learned how to make polite conversation, how to keep the tone positive and constructive, how to find something to compliment about the other person. Ms. Bizzini went on and on about the proper way to greet someone you're meeting for the first time. How old did she think we were? 4? We knew how to greet someone.
Now I want you to pair up and practice this,
Ms. Bizzini said. My heart hammering, I turned and tapped the big kid sitting to my left on the shoulder. Want to be partners? But Ms. Bizzini was going down the rows, pointing with forked fingers, calling out pairs of names. And as she came down my row, I could see who those forked fingers were going to pair me with. Ben and Eve. My lips went numb. My fingertips, too. There was no way I could use them to shake this monster's hand. I wanted to cry or scream. I wanted my mother, but more than anything, I wanted to run. Do not repeat, earbud guy said. Here we go, Ben. This may be hard to believe, but she's as nervous as you are. Stand up and face her.
I didn't want to. I so didn't want to, but I did what the voice said because that's what you do. You do what adults tell you, especially in school.
The creature went on, staring straight ahead. Hi, my name is Ben, earbud guy said. It took me a moment to remember I was supposed to repeat that. I opened my crater dry mouth and said,
Hi, my name is Ben.
The creature turned her head ever so slightly.
This is a stupid exercise, isn't it? The voice prompted.
I repeated it. The creature ignored me.
It's good to meet you anyway, Eve, the voice said. Direction. Now extend your hand and offer to shake.
There was no way I was going to do that. I had seen the way barbs could come stabbing out of this thing. The words I could say, though.
It's good to meet you anyway, Eve.
I turned to sit.
Direction! The voice nearly shouted. Now offer her your hand. Don't let me down here, Ben.
I hesitated. The voice was like an invisible hand pushing me, turning me. I didn't want to do this. I so didn't want to. I stuck out my trembling hand. Eve looked at it, then away. I went to drop my hand, but earbud guy jumped in.
Direction, keep it there.
I stood there with my hand in the air, trembling from head to toe. Everyone in the room was watching while trying not to make it obvious, probably getting direction from their earbud voices telling them not to stare. Eve raised her hand, or hoof, or whatever it was, without looking at me. I looked down at the fat stump of purple flesh.
Do not repeat. Yes. Good.
Earbud guy shouted.
Her fingers are about 4 inches up her arm. See them?
I nodded. There were 4 of them, writhing around like they had minds of their own.
Don't nod. Grasp 2 of the fingers very gently and shake them once.
I was panting like I just ran a marathon as I grasped what looked like 2 purplish worms, shook the mushy, jiggly things for a split second, then brought my hand back and lunged into my seat.
Do not repeat. Nice work, Ben. Nice, nice work.
In the background, I thought I could hear other voices, just barely. They sounded like they were cheering. My heart slowed as relief washed over me. I'd survived.
What kind of school was this?
As Ms. Bizzini went on about formal versus informal greetings, I looked over at Lorena, but she didn't notice. She was busy being in shock, staring glassy-eyed at the board. Persephone, on the other hand, caught my eye and gave me a knowing smile, like she was somehow enjoying this. I was not. I felt as if Eve might turn at any minute and take a bite out of my face. I fixed my gaze on the dry erase board and tried to forget what was sitting beside me. After class, if I survived, I'd ask one of the adults in this loony bin if I could switch seats. Chapter 3. Usually the second night in a strange place is easier than the first, but this place felt worse than it had the night before. As I lay in bed, staring out through the window at the black sky, I was sure I was never going to sleep again, because if I did, I might dream of Eve's fingers. "This is so screwed up," Lorena said from the bed next to mine. "Yep." I waited anxiously for Earbud Guy to cut in and tell me to change the conversation, but he was silent. "This is a test of some sort." Persephone was lying flat on the bed to my left, looking up at the ceiling. The kids at the other end of the room were whispering urgently to each other, probably having the same conversation as us. "What do you mean?" I asked. "It's faked somehow, to test how we respond." "I promise you she's not fake." I'd touched her, I would know. "Been to the movies lately?" Persephone asked. "You can create incredibly lifelike effects if you have the money." Could she be fake? Could Eve be a guy inside a costume, the spine's remote control? That was hard to imagine, but what explanation for Eve wasn't far-fetched. "She has to be an alien," I said. "Either from another planet or pulled from an alternate dimension." I'd read and watched enough science fiction to recognize an alien when I saw one.
"And they decided the thing to do was put the alien in a classroom with a bunch of seventh graders and teach her how to shake hands properly?"
Persephone's voice dripped sarcasm.
"That makes perfect sense. I'm telling you, we're the subjects in this experiment."
"It's not an experiment." Lorena was still sitting on the edge of her bed in sweats. "I don't think she's an alien, though." Persephone sat up on her elbows.
"There's a third possibility? Okay. What do you think she is?"
"Whatever name you want to give her, she's not something you can explain with science." Lorena hesitated, like she wanted to say more, but was afraid we'd laugh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.